Now, speaking of volunteers, I do need one for this morning. Welcome to Vintage Grace. My name is Drew. I have the privilege of serving on staff as one of the pastors. If you've got extra space, if you could just squeeze in, we'll make some extra seats on the outside as parents are coming in looking for seats. Front row, as always, is available. So if you're ever looking for space, no worries there at all. But I need a volunteer, one that's relatively hungry. Maybe you are racing your kids to get here to sing. Anyone willing to volunteer? I need a hungry volunteer. What is this? Hungry volunteer, anybody? Going one, right there. Benson, come here real quick. I want to give you something, buddy. I've got something for you, and I just thought it would be really good if you had a donut this morning.
I'm actually hungry. So
here you go. This is a donut. Now, before you leave, I don't know if you realize, but we actually offer donuts every Sunday. They're on the patio. It's really not that special that I'm giving Eric a donut, you know. But he said he was hungry, so I wanted to give you some time to eat today. But before you run off with that, I want to know if that would satisfy you or if you'd be open to trading that for something better. You open to something better? So I'm willing to, if you're up for it, I've got a whole pound of bacon here with some garnish. So if you'd rather, I'll give you bacon for the donut. You'd rather? All right, so here's some bacon. You're welcome to share that, buddy. Go, you're done, man. That's it. That's all I need. That's all I needed for you. Here's some napkins, because if you share, you're gonna. I mean, I woke up nice and early this morning and wanted to get some bacon. So this morning, we're in Luke chapter 14. We're actually finishing Luke chapter 14. If you have your Bibles, pull them out. We're Luke 14, and one of the things that we're gonna talk about this morning is discipleship. And something that I've realized and kind of recognized in my world, and again, I don't want to shove my insecurities, my issues on you, but you live in my world. And in my world, I've started to recognize something. The idea of commitment, of making a decision, of raising your hand, of volunteering, of signing up for something, of saying, hey, I'm going to take that, I'm going to own that. Like, commitment is quickly becoming a lost art in our society, is it not? And what I mean by that is you can get offered a donut and be like, dude, I'm hungry. I'm all in. And I take the donut. And then all of a sudden, something better comes along. And what does Benson do? I'm out, right? I don't want this donut. I mean, this donut, it's sparkly. It's sugary. It's not really going to satisfy. So we often get opportunities in our life to make decisions, to sign up for things, to say I'm in for something. And yet how quickly in our world, if we get a better offer, are we done? I mean, there's cell phone contracts, right? You know when you sign that cell phone contract and you're like, I'm stuck with you forever, right? Until another better option comes and even that competitor says, I'm gonna buy you out, right? Like, commitment is not something that we're used to. In fact, we see that all the time in our life, you know, where we make a decision, we commit to something, and then something else comes along and we believe on some level that's gonna make us happier. Is that not one of the biggest issues in jobs? We believe something's gonna make us happier. Faithfulness, commitment. How about marriage? I mean, let's just be direct. Like, marriage today, the commitment, when I stand up as a pastor and say, do you and do you, here's the reality, here's the fear in my life. Way too many people say, well, I do until I don't. Because that's the world we live in. And so this morning, we're gonna talk about what I think is the most important commitment that any one of us can make. It's not a cell phone contract. It's not a donut. It's not even a marriage. It's relationship with God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and what he offers us when we say we're in. When we recognize that he has chose us, when we recognize that the grave is empty, and we say that we're in, the question is, have we truly committed? When we live in a world where commitment's so loose, where commitment doesn't necessarily mean what it used to mean. And here's my greatest fear. It sure as heck doesn't mean what it meant in the first century. So this morning, as we look at Luke, here's my summary statement for this morning. Commitment to Jesus far exceeds any other commitment that we will ever choose to decide or to follow or to make. Commitment to Jesus is so intense. It's so real. It's so personal. It's so practical. And one of my fears is for those of us today in our town, we might not understand the offer that Jesus is making to his disciples and to the crowds that are listening to him. Now, we use language like their town and our town. We read the Bible. I don't know if you know this or not, but the Bible wasn't written to you. The Bible was written in this context. The book of Luke was written to a guy named Theophilus back in the first century. And he wrote this letter so that Theophilus might have certainty of who Jesus was and what he was about. And sometimes when we read an old historical text, we lose the meaning and the significance because there's a huge gap between their town in first century Jerusalem and in our town in 21st century El Dorado Hills. And one of my fears is that word commitment, that gap between first century and 21st century is huge. But may you recognize this morning, in spite of that cultural construct, in spite of that gap, the cost of being a disciple then and still the cost today is high. But brothers and sisters, I believe that it is worth it. If you have your Bibles, pull them out. Luke chapter 14, follow along with me. We're going to see that as we finish, starting in verse 25. Here's the text this morning. Now, great crowds accompanied him, and he turned and he said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, if he doesn't even hate his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Super seeker sensitive morning, guys. The bar's low. If you don't do these things, whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you desiring to build a tower does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to actually complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all who will see it will begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king going out to encounter another king in war will not first sit down and deliberate whether he is able to with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is a far way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, any of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It's thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Father God, this morning as we read your word, may that word not be information, but may be transformational to our hearts. May we recognize and understand what it is meant when you give us the call to discipleship, to follow you. To be your disciple, may we recognize in our world where commitment is low, that your call on us is high and it's worth it. May we see that today through the power of your word, Spirit, speak boldly to us for your glory and for our good. And everybody said, amen. Here's the text this morning as we kind of walk through the text. You got to remember the setting. We took a little bit of a break last week at Easter. We're back in the right in the middle of Luke. And Luke, Jesus has been teaching at a banquet table for really the last 3 weeks for us as a church. He's been teaching about the kingdom of God, that the kingdom of God is accessible to all, but that the way to the kingdom of God is narrow, that Jesus is the only way, that he is the truth, the life. And so the way is narrow, it's specific. But once you get to the kingdom of God and once you get inside, do you remember how wide it is? That the banqueting table has lots of seats, that life with Jesus is available to anyone who will just choose to walk in the way that Jesus called us to live. But the way is narrow and the door is also pretty low. In humility, we have to get off the throne of our lives and say, Jesus, you are king. There's only one king in a kingdom. You are king. So Jesus has been teaching, and really since chapter 11, he's really been focusing on the Pharisees and all the leaders that are around. He's been spending all this time with the leaders of the day saying, I think you might have missed the gospel. Please don't miss the gospel. Life with me is the best. It's the best. And don't miss it because it's different than the way in which you've been describing it for other people. So he's been teaching us and he's been teaching the leaders. And this morning we're going to see a little bit of a pivot. He's leaving the leaders. He hasn't given up on them. The door is always open until they die. Then the door shut. But the door is open for them to receive Jesus, the way in which he said. But now he's pivoting away because now there's this kind of scene shift that's taken place. He's no longer at the banqueting table with all the Pharisees that people are listening and watching. Now there's these great crowds that are following Jesus. They've been following Jesus for months and years, some of them. They've been following Jesus because he's proclaiming the kingdom of God. He's proclaiming a better way of life. He's proclaiming life with the Father. And so all these crowds have been gathering and they're coming to him. And often when Luke teaches, we see these crowds show up. Now this morning, often when Luke tells a story of Jesus, someone in the crowd asks a question. You remember that? Someone asks a question and Jesus will address it. This is not a question that comes from the crowd. I think that's important for us this morning. This is not a question that someone who is listening to Jesus asks. I feel like this is a statement from Jesus saying, there's lots of crowds right here right now, but do you understand what you're here for? Because in Jesus' mind, a big crowd was never the goal. It was never the goal. I think on some level, Jesus says, if you understood what I was offering your relationship with me, maybe you wouldn't be here. Maybe you'd take off. Maybe the cost would be too high. But Jesus' commitment, and I love this, and it's our commitment as elders and as a church, we're not actually looking for great crowds. That's not the goal. We're looking for committed disciples. committed disciples of the gospel and of Jesus. So there are all these great crowds that are following Jesus, but he takes a point not because of a question. He makes a statement. He says, all you great crowds, do you understand why you're here? Like, this isn't like Easter Sunday. Like, why are you here? It's not for family tradition. It's not because you think you should. The cost to follow me and really follow me is going to be high. And so what we see in this morning's text, I've already read it. Maybe you're like, Jesus has said this before. Luke isn't repeating himself for no good reason. Jesus has been talking to the disciples twice in chapter 9. If you remember, he says almost verbatim what we're going to look at today. Now, here's the reality. I preached chapter 9 like 8 months ago, so none of you remember, right? So you can go back and listen to that sermon, very similar to this one. But in chapter 9, he says this to his disciples. He says, there's a joy when you deny yourself, pick up your cross, deny yourself, and follow me. Those three things. That's what it means to be a disciple. This is why we say, Jesus was a great salesman. Never. His sales pitch was deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me to Golgotha and die. And everyone's like, yes, I want to be on your team, right? And so there's all these crowds. He's like, hey, do you understand what I'm inviting you to? Do you understand what I'm inviting you to as you follow me? So he said in chapter 9, later in that same chapter, he says this, what happens as I invite people to follow me is the excuses start to happen, right? Over and over again. Well, I got my brother, and I got my this, and I got my that, and I got all these things that are actually a higher priority than Jesus. And we see that through the life of the disciple, and actually as the disciple retreating. But that's what Jesus wants to talk about this morning. He wants to talk about discipleship. What does it mean? Now, that word is a tough word. How many of you ever heard the word discipleship? Anybody? How many of you guys have a definition that you love for discipleship? Anybody? What? Now, here's my concern in the church. We throw that word around all the time, and we're like, what does that mean? So you guys can Google like I can. I'm a really good Googler, right? It means pupil. It means learner. It means follower. Follower of Jesus. But here's my frustration. We follow things until we what? Don't want to. As Jesus is saying, if you follow me, you better understand what you're signing up for. You better understand what it is. Now, I hope if I ask this question next week, people actually raise their hand for the second part of the question. We all have different definitions of discipleship. At Vintage, we have one. You know what it's called? Anybody know? I got a Starbucks card. If you know what we call a disciple of Vintage Grace, they live what? Yeah. R cubed. Woo! Oh my goodness, I quit. I'm done. I'm retiring. One person in my church knows what discipleship is. We call it R cubed. And maybe you've heard us talk about that. R1 is a deepening relationship with God. R2 is a life-changing relationship with other believers. Not I come in and I go and I kind of attend church. No, I'm a part of a family of God. And R3 is an engaging relationship with the yet to believe. That's what a disciple is. And that's what it means to be a disciple. Not R1 sometimes and R2 on Tuesdays and R3 like twice a year because it's Christmas and Easter and we better, right? It's R cubed. It's living a life of the abundant, joy-filled Christian life. And we believe in His grace. There's no better life than being a disciple of Christ. But it comes with a cost. And so Jesus is going to pull apart what discipleship is. And he's going to give us really two key examples as to what a disciple is. And let me tell you, I read it already. It's intense. Here's what Jesus says. If anyone wants to be my disciple, if anyone wants to come after me, maybe you're just exploring Jesus right now. Thanks for being here. We all have been explorers at one point. Maybe you haven't made that decision yet, and you're trying to figure this out. Hear me say, often in the church, I've seen us lower the bar of discipleship so great crowds would come. That doesn't do anybody any favors. Here's the call of discipleship. Two examples. Here's the first one. If anyone wants to come after me and be my disciple and does not, you say it, hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters. I didn't say it. My job as a preacher is to quote Jesus. That's all I do. Because someone is going to leave this morning upset because they heard that word and they stopped listening. Tune back in for a moment, church. Here's what Jesus says. If you want to follow me, if you want to be my disciple, you must hate your father and mother. Let's just start there because I don't want to get to my wife and my kids yet. That's way more personal. I'm a grown man in theory, right? So mom and dad are more distant now. Let's just deal with the easy one. Hate your father and mother. Does Jesus hate family units? No, he created them. He designed them. Is family good? Yes. When Jesus is saying the word hate, I think on some level he is trying to shock the sleeper and the listener in the audience to say, are you listening? He's saying, you must hate your mother and your father. You must hate your wife and your children. Now, I said last week at Easter that I wouldn't give my son for anybody. Is family good? Are your kids good? Is your wife good? Don't say that out loud if you're wondering. I think the answer is yes. In fact, Jesus used to tell us, remember back in the Sermon on the Mount, Sermon on the Plain, chapter 6? Jesus would say this, we as Christians don't hate anybody. We don't have any enemies. The definition of an enemy is when you seek to do someone harm. As Christians, we have no enemies. People might have us as an enemy, but we have no enemies. Remember that? No one that we wish to do harm. Jesus says, but I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you. So if we do good to those who hate us, how much more good do we do to those who love us, right? Like our family. I don't think when Jesus says, hate your father and mother, I'm not trying to be apologetic for Jesus. I'm not trying to say he made a mistake. I think he does this on purpose. He's saying, hate your father and mother. And I think what he's saying is this. He's not saying literally hate your mother and father. He's saying, if you want to be my disciple, if you want to follow me, your devotion to me is going to be so strong and so real and so intense that compared to anything else, it's going to look like hatred towards those other things. That's what Jesus is saying. Here's what I mean. Eric Benson, do you hate donuts? You don't hate donuts? You should. Right? Because it's just not good for you. But here's what Jesus says. Compared to life with me, I hate donuts. That's what he's saying. He's saying, compared to life with me, I will choose the better every single time. And our devotion to Jesus and bacon is so strong and so intense and it's so real and it's so eternal and it means so much more. Hear me. It means so much more than your relationship with your parents, than your spouse, and your kids. See, signing up to be a disciple doesn't mean you got one more cool, like, practical hobby. But is that not true for the evangelical Christian church today? It's just one more list in our priorities. How do we shove in our Jesus time, right? And so here's the point from Jesus. If you want to be my disciple, if you want to follow me, I'm not saying that you're actually going to reject everything else. What I'm saying is the way in which you love me, the affections that you have towards me, compared to the affections you have towards anything else this world has to offer, that will look like hate. Do you see that, church? See, the issue that Jesus is going after is idolatry right now. That's what he wants to talk about. Now, does Jesus talk about idolatry a ton in the Old Testament? Seven of you say yes. Over and over and over again. And here's what idolatry is. Idolatry is any time we give more value to something than God created it to have. That's what idolatry is. You know the biggest idol in the Church of El Dorado Hills today? I think it's family. I think it's mothers and fathers. I think it's kids, brothers and sisters. And that we have decided that our allegiance is family. That matters most. And here's what Jesus says. Family does not matter most. In fact, when you think about family compared to allegiance in my family, that looks like hatred compared to this, which is love. And if not, all of these things, I think, have a temptation to become idols in the heart of everybody. Is family good? Is having kids good, depending on their age? Is having a wife good, a husband, a spouse? But here's the reality, are any of those things God things? Any of them? They're good things that were created by a good creator. How high is the list of good creations? Anybody know? It's high. And yet here's what Jesus says. We use this picture as a throne of our heart often. Here's what Jesus says, on the throne of your heart, many of you have stacked good things on top of one another. Now again, I'd like you to metaphorically picture my mom, my dad, my wife, my son, my daughter, my other son, right? I mean, were they good? Were they stinking cute? Like, that was awesome. I'm coming back second service just so I can hear them again. And we stack all these God thing, good things on the throne of our heart. And here's what Jesus says. Like, that vacancy is one. So the list of good things is lots. How many God things, persons, beings are there? One. And that's the point that Jesus makes. You want to be my disciple, you recognize there's vacancy for one in the throne of your heart, and that's me, and that's it. And in comparison to all the other good things, you recognize that they had the temptation to just become idols if I don't clear space, if I don't clear out my houses. As Jesus has been saying this to his disciples, now he says it to the crowd. He says, yes, even your own life. Because if you don't worship your family, all of us worship ourselves. We're the ones that have put ourselves on the throne of our lives. He says, yes, even his own family, he cannot be my disciple. In fact, he goes one step further. When we follow Jesus, do we remember where he's going? Again, I think some of it's like, oh, cool, Easter's done. Well, actually, not in chapter 14. It's not done yet. He's going to Golgotha. And so here's what Jesus says in the next verse. He says, whoever does not bear his own cross, that's the cross beam that you would hold and they would give to convicted criminals. And they would carry their cross towards their place of crucifixion. So here's what Jesus says. Not only is your family temptation to be an idol, but your own health. How many of you guys take care of your own health? Anybody? How many of you guys should do a better job taking your own health? Anybody? Here's what Jesus says. Your own health in comparison to the kingdom of God is no longer a highest value. Health can be an idolatry, can it not? So Jesus says, this is about idolatry. You must bear your own cross. In fact, coming after me may come with a cost. For the first century disciples, it did. They gave their lives for the sake of the gospel because following Jesus was worth it. It was worth their family. It was worth their own life. And if you don't, you cannot be my disciple. He says it in 26 and in 27. Jesus wants to understand, going to church doesn't mean, yes, I'm a Christian. I know a lot of Christians. I know a lot of people that go to church. Those numbers aren't the same. And so Jesus is trying to ask us the hard question, which is, hey, lots of people are coming. Now remember, when Jesus dies, where'd everybody go? They recognized the cost and they bailed. The text goes on and he says, would you reflect on the cost? Would you think about it? The cost is real. It's real. And Christians, we do our pre-believing friends no favor. We're like, oh, it's no big deal to be a Christian. It's no big deal. It's a huge deal. It's a realignment of your heart. It's a Jesus takes priority. It's a Jesus is king. It's a big deal. It's the most important thing you will ever decide to do in your life, for this life and for the next. And so here's what Jesus says. Jesus is not interested in attendance. He's not interested in having a bigger crowd, because when the rubber meets the road and they all bail, he's like, they clearly didn't get it. He's interested in discipleship, in commitment, in being sold out to the gospel. That's what he's interested in. So he gives us two examples saying, count the cost. This matters. Here's the first one. For which of you is desiring to build a tower? Now, when we think about building a tower, it's like any construction project. Now, let me just tell you real quickly, this isn't about the construction project. But think about phase two. We gutted this sanctuary, or phase one. We gutted the sanctuary. We counted the cost. We're thankful for this place. Towers in their day and age were good things. It was a place where you could look out and see everything that was going on in the world, and you could use it as a guard post. Towers were good things. We've already seen towers in the Gospel of Luke. Remember, there was the tower in Jerusalem that fell and people died. But Jesus' point for the tower is simply this. His point is, if you're going to build a tower, you must first sit down and count the cost, not because it might fail or you might cut corners. He says you must count the cost because if you start a project that you're not ready to finish, that's a tragedy. Here's what he says, count the cost to see if you are ready and if you have enough to complete it. Otherwise, when you lay the foundation, you're not able to finish, all those who will see you will begin to do what? Mock you. Now, their day and age, honor and shame were high values. This is part of why, again, when Jesus says, hate your mother and father, they're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Didn't you say honor your mother and father? He's like, yes, I need you to understand what I'm talking about here. In the same way that honor is a huge value, mockery, shame, huge value. Bullying did not start in middle school. It started back here. When people would start a project and they didn't do it, and what would happen is you'd walk by your neighbor's house and be like, ha, you're that guy. You're that guy that was like, I'm gonna build a tower and it's gonna be bigger than your tower, because they got the same issues we do, right? And they say, wait, what? You said you were going to do this, and you didn't. And when it's not finished, all those who saw it will mock him, saying, this man began to build what he was not able to finish. Guys, this is not about construction. That's not what this text is about. This text is about sitting down and counting the cost to understand, what is it that I'm signing up for? Do I recognize what I am signing up for? That's cost number one. Don't do something that you're not ready to follow through on. Here's cost number two. Encounters another king in war, and he will not sit down first and deliberate. See, you saw it in both sections, right? One and two. We must stop. Our following Jesus can't be just an emotional decision. It's got to be head and heart, wholly both. We must stop and sit down and deliberate. Is this Jesus worth it? Don't answer. It's easy in church to say, heck yeah. It's a lot harder when you get out into life. And so here's what Jesus says. Will you not first sit down and deliberate whether he is able with 10,000 men to come against those with 20,000 men? And if he looks out and says, man, the other one, we're in trouble. So if not, you should send a great way off, send a delegation, and ask for terms of peace. Because here's what Jesus says. It's one thing to be mocked. It's another thing to die. It's one thing to be mocked, and Jesus says the opportunity, the cost of following Jesus may actually lead you to death. And he's talking to the crowds and saying, are you ready? Because here's what I think Jesus says. Even the difference between example number one and example number two is simply this. I feel like there's this sense of when we first sign up to follow Jesus, have we counted the cost to build the tower? That's what he's saying in example one. In example two, there's a sense of like, as you walk with Jesus, do you recognize that every day you're saying death to me? You're saying John the Baptist prayer, right? Less of me and more of he. You're saying not my kingdom, but thy kingdom. And so every day there's this death, but it's a good death. Do we like death at Vintage Grace? Were you here on Good Friday? Do we like death? Yes. And as Christians, are we afraid of death? No. Okay, let me clarify. As a disciple, are we ever afraid of death? No. Death is a gateway to glory. Death does not harm us. But here's the example that Jesus says. Are you counting the cost of what it means to actually follow me? Do you want peace? And if so, you better find that in Jesus. And here's the question. Is it worth it? Is following Jesus worth it? That's the question. Is it worth it? We have a value at Vintage Grace that says this: we believe there's more joy in Jesus than anything or anyone else. So if you're a part of Vintage Grace, here's what we've said as a church: we think it's worth it. But that doesn't mean there isn't a cost, but we think it's worth it. And joy compels us and motivates us. And it caused us to do things that the rest of the world might look in at disciples and say, that's crazy. Well, guys, that's what it means to be a Christian. Like, that's just the definition. I'm gonna write some book called Crazy Love, because that's what it's all written in, right? That's what it's all about. It started with crazy love of the Father towards us, and now it comes out of us in crazy love towards other. Faith does not stop with a decision. It starts with one, church. And once you make that decision in faith to follow Jesus, how many more faith decisions do you need to make? Forever, until Jesus calls you home. Faith doesn't start with a decision. Faith doesn't stop with that decision. It starts with one. And so here's some of the decisions we talked about just this morning. God actually is more valuable and more powerful and of worth way more value than your family. Now again, if you know how valuable I think my family is, you understand how valuable I'm saying my God is. I love my family. Then next he says, God is more valuable than your health. Now if you know how valuable I think health is, when you have a son that's battled cancer, you understand how much I value health, right? But infinitely more valuable is the glory of God than my family and my health. And if you forgot third grade math, because again, I'm in third grade all over again, the alligator eats the bigger number, right? God! God! And this invitation of discipleship is in the joy of the relationship that God offers you. And then we get to another idol in our heart, which is wealth. See, Jesus' definition of commitment is not low. It's not low. Now, let me be very clear. As we dive into health and wealth and family, Jesus is like, I don't want to leave any stone unturned. I don't want to leave any loophole. I'm going to find the three biggest attacks of the enemy for your throne of your heart that we often put things there instead of me, family, health, and wealth. Now, let me tell you, I don't think that these are three entrance fees to the kingdom of God. Hear that, church. I don't think that these are three entrance fees to the kingdom of God. Jesus isn't saying, if you want to be my disciple, you reject your family, you reject your health, you reject your wealth. But what he is saying, if that was ever an opportunity or if that was ever forced upon you, the choice isn't that difficult. I'm going to say that again because I'm afraid we read this and we're like, I'm so confused. And we're like, let's skip this passage. Let's go to the next, right? That's what us good evangelicals do. Jesus isn't saying, to be my disciple, you must run away from your family, start to hurt yourself, and give away all your money. That's not what he's saying. He's not saying that we pursue family awfulness. If you have family awfulness, no worries. But that could be because there's sinners in your family, not because you're choosing Jesus. If you're in debt because of bad decisions, that's because you made bad decisions, not because you chose to follow Jesus. Does that make sense? He's not saying the entrance fee to the kingdom is family, health, and wealth. He's saying that if given the opportunity to choose one or the other, is it that big of a choice? No, it's really not. And here's what he says in verse 33. So therefore, any of you who does not renounce all that he has. Now, I love it. Jesus, I mean, it's so easy, right? So easy. If any of you does not renounce all that he has, he cannot what, church? Be my disciple. So when you say you're a Christian, can we just make sure we're all on the same page as to what the heck that means? Because I'm much more comfortable with us being like, I don't know. I know, but I'm much more comfortable when my friends and my family say, I don't know yet. Is Jesus worth it all? So some of you know. Some of you have made that decision of discipleship. And here's what I love about the early century disciples. They lived this. This wasn't rhetoric. This wasn't like, well, being a disciple means that you go to church 1.4 times a month and you give 2.7% of your income and you serve at base camp because we're desperate for leaders. But is that not kind of what we've described discipleship as in the Church of America? And I'm not trying to beat up the Church of America, but it doesn't look like Jesus' first century discipleship, does it? So he says this, if you want to be my disciple, you need to renounce all that you have. And here's what's so fun. I'm growing in my OST. I hope you are too. But stuff just doesn't matter as much as it used to. Have you recognized that the more you follow Jesus? If you lose stuff, you're like, shucks. I say shucks, forgive me. It's just not that big of a deal. I'm not saying be a bad steward. I'm not saying be irresponsible. But if I was to lose something, I joke all the time. I don't lock my car door. If there's anything you want, go for it. It's open all the time. Starbucks, Bella Brew, CrossFit, like it's there. There's just nothing I own that I care about. So it's on you if you want to steal my Bible. That's about all that's in there. And so the saint today in the first century, and I think also today says this, look, I can renounce everything because I recognize, as Piper says, there are no U-Hauls behind hearses. Nothing's going with me. So everything that I have is solely focused on the kingdom of God. That's it. My time, my treasure, my talent. So I can live with something that I don't need. In fact, here's what Jesus says. If Jesus isn't first, he's last. He doesn't want to just be the on your list. He is the list. And so if he's not first, here's what Jesus says. I'm actually last. That's an important thing for us to figure out before we meet Jesus face to face. He is the priority. Everything else flows from that. In fact, here's what I love. I'm actually a better husband because I'm a Christian. I'm a better father because I'm a Christian. I'm a better Little League coach because I'm a Christian. Everything flows from the reality that I am a disciple of Christ, though, and that he is first. It's Jesus plus nothing. Because here's what happens in our life. When we're clinging to health and to wealth and to family, you know what we're not doing? We're not clinging to Jesus. Vacancy for one in the throne of your heart. What are you clinging to is the question this morning. As a disciple, there's one answer, Jesus. Jesus plus nothing. Nothing. And that's what I cling to. And then Jesus gives us this final warning, and I love it, because what would be Luke and Jesus' sermons if he wasn't like, and if you don't, here's what it says. Salt is good. Does anyone think salt is good? Benson, how would that, Benson's gone, his kid. No, there he is. Benson, have you ever had bacon without salt? It's a terrible experience. Salt is good, amen? Amen? Salt is a good thing. Here's what Jesus says. I think he's talking about his disciples. Discipleship is good. Disciples are good. There's a role for you to play in my kingdom of bacon. And so here's what Jesus says. He says, salt is good, but if it has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? I think he's just talking about the Dead Sea, and here's what happens in the Dead Sea. It's an element of endurance is what faith is. It's an enduring of the saints. And what happens to the salt when we hit the moisture and the other elements that come together is that salt does not endure in the Dead Sea, and it actually loses its saltiness. Saints, you can sign up to be a Christian, but over time, that's when we know. When the rubber meets the road, that's when you know. Is he really my everything, or was he just something? And was I ready to trade him in for the next thing? And the bummer there is it's so short-sighted. Bacon is so much better than donuts. And we trade stuff in. We think all the time. And it's short-sighted. And here's what the text says. Salt that's lost its saltiness is of no use to the soil or for the manure pile. It's thrown away. And this sounds like last chapter, does it not? Where Jesus says this, look, if you're a fruit tree and don't produce fruit, guess what's going to happen to you? But if not, just cut it down. Because it's not what I designed it for. Disciples, he designed you to live R-cubed for your joy, for his glory. Those go together to live R-cubed. Disciples, recognize the call and joyfully run into it. Don't miss it, which is why Jesus ends this text. He says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Jesus says, I love you. I don't want you to miss this. But I'm also not really pumped with the big crowds because I know big crowds don't actually equal big faith. Because faith comes in the size of what? Anybody remember? Mustard seed. That's what I'm after, Jesus says. But if you are listening to me, please hear. Please hear. I called our Connect cards this past week. I had so many awesome conversations with people that had never gone to church before. And here's what I'm experiencing with people that have never gone to church before. They tend to get it better than those who go to church. Because they have ears to hear and they're like, oh yeah, of course, that's what it looks like. You can't have Jesus and money as a master. You can't have Jesus and your family. You'll be righteously divided. But I can be all in for Jesus. That's the call and the cost of discipleship. So here's the implication for us this morning. The door is narrow and low, but the bar to get in is high. Because once you're in, you're like, I don't want to settle for anything else. I want to settle for less. And my fear, of course, is the gap between first century Christianity and 21st century Christianity might look different, but not ever. I've got a buddy. Come on up. Where's my mic, Jason? Maybe you're going to run it up to me. I don't know where my mic is. I'm coming. I'm walking. Warmer, hotter. There we go. Come on up, Gus. Gus is a friend of mine. Carl is one of our missionaries over in India. And Gus, as I was doing the sermon prep this morning, I'm wrestling with this reality that in America, we struggle with this understanding of the cost and the call of discipleship. But when you first came to faith, this wasn't just some verse in a Bible. This was real life, was it not? What did that look like for you?
Well, when I came to faith in Jesus Christ, my parents were totally opposed to it. And so at the young age of 15, I actually had to leave my home. And I lived on the streets of the city of Kolkata, lived in the parks. And my parents thought I would mess up my life. And God's hand was upon me. And 6 months later, my parents invited me back home to live.
So this idea of like, you got to choose Jesus or your family, maybe that's not in your future. It was in his. This call of following Jesus wasn't something, because cultural Christianity, do you guys have Christianity in Kolkata? You do?
Yes.
It can't be as bad as here, is it?
Not too bad.
I mean, part of me loves this. I'm not saying we should all go move to Kolkata, but maybe some of us should, where there's a cost. And so you as a 15, 16-year-old, make this decision to follow Jesus. So it's Jesus in the streets or my family, yes. And you chose Jesus.
Yes.
Is that the real deal? Now, how do we know it's the real deal? Well, when the family came back and said, hey, man, here's your Lamborghini, here's your, right? You were all in on this Jesus guy.
Absolutely.
Following him, committed to him. Now, here, how many years ago was that? Not that we care about ages.
That was in 1984.
1984.
Yes.
As a young man making the decision to follow Jesus. Now, you commit solely to Jesus. That story continues on, and you end up moving back in with your parents. What did that look like? How many years later was that?
Well, 6 months later, I moved back with my parents. And then when I was 19 years old, I sensed the call of God for full-time ministry. Hmm. And it was a struggle because my family situation was not good financially. Hmm. And so the choice to go and work and take care of my family needs, but then the choice to obey God's call upon my life to go for full-time ministry. And I chose to go for full-time ministry.
Family, wealth, provision. So you actually believe that God is a truth teller. You believe that God's going to take care of you.
Absolutely.
And so you've made choices because of that belief. Now here we are 30 years later. And again, where are your parents at in their faith journey?
When I got married way back in 1995, my wife and myself lived in one single room. But the salvation of our family was utmost on our hearts. And so we made the choice to invite my mom and my dad and my younger brother to come live with us in this one single room.
Which sounds like a great idea for family dynamics, does it not? Right? And so you invite them in, you all live together, and what does God do in that moment?
And that opened up the door for us to share Jesus Christ with my family. And from the year 1995 till 2001, my family lived with us, and they came to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior.
Hmm. What year was that?
My parents came to know Christ in 1998.
3 years. At what point with mother-in-law living in your home is your wife like, hey, babe, this whole, like, Jesus got a timeline here, right? Like, if there's no fruit on the tree, you cut it down, right? And so you see how discipleship's about endurance. This isn't, like, for the faint of heart. Like, when we go all in, we go all in. And this is why I love this, brother. This isn't a joke. And so you've given up even better career opportunities. Now you're a pastor. And what is your passion as a pastor?
Well, I was a senior associate pastor of a mega church in the city of Kolkata. But our church was not focused on church planting and reaching out. So I actually took a step of faith and resigned from that church and began to do church planting in the city of Kolkata.
Wow. Do we like church planting? Like, it's what we care about. And really, what we're multiplying in church plants, let's just be really clear, we're multiplying disciples and disciple makers. And so you've made this decision. You gave us some extra security. Not that often we talk about church's security, but give some church security job to plant churches. And what does that look like for you today?
Well, we have a vision called Vision 2020. And by the year 2020, we want to see 20 churches being planted in the city of Kolkata. Hmm. And we started out this year. And by God's grace, we have already planted 4 churches.
So I don't know what we're waiting for, church. You know, not that it's competition, but 4 in a year. I mean, we are sincerely behind. But I love this, your passion for planting churches. So you're pastoring a church, you're coaching church planters. And Carl, how do you connect with this guy? Because again, one of the joys of my relationship with you is we don't get to know Gus if not for you. So what is your role here with Gus?
Well, it's a pleasure for me to be here with Gus today. And so you guys have known that I'm a missionary and I travel, but you may not connect what does that look like because I'm here often and then I'm gone and maybe you think I'm an unfaithful church attender. But what I'm doing is I'm going out and I'm looking for guys like Gus. I'm looking for guys who have a passion for reaching their city, for multiplying churches, and that they're all in. And so Gus has given up 2 pastoral roles to step out into church planting. Because he sees the need in the city, because in his city there's 18 million people. The population density is 64,000 people per square mile. And yet only 0.9% of the people in that city are followers of Christ. And so if you want to have churches multiplied in groups of, say, 25 in a square mile, you need to have 256 groups meeting in churches, and what's it going to take to meet that need? And yeah. So he realized a church of 3,000 that he was a senior associate in was really great, but they weren't reaching out to the other people.
Yep.
And so that's the passion, and that's the vision, and so I'm out looking for people like us. If I went out and said I'm going to pay guys to church plant, I could have 100 guys right now. But if I want to see guys that are really going to see people transform their community and make the choice to see them grow into true disciples, I need to find guys like Gus.
Yep.
That are willing to give it all up to be faithful to what God has called them to do.
And so recognize, church, this is what we care about. We care about your personal discipleship, and we care about this on a macro level as well. That's why we say at Vintage Grace, don't give to us, give through us. Thank you for the Multiply Initiative. We do have a new building because of it, but you know what I'm most excited about is that this place is being used as a hub for disciple making and to send people like Matt Moore in Oak Park, but also like Carl in India and Andy in Africa and Cyprian and Gus. And so if you got your giving statement in the mail this week, just your quarterly giving statement, thank you. Thank you, because this is what we care about, and this is what we do together as disciples, is we invest in the multiplication of more disciples and of kingdom laborers, because the harvest is plentiful. And we recognize that the door is narrow and it's also low and that the bar is high and that many people aren't going to make the choice that Gus made. But we also believe that that choice is the best choice. Give these guys a round of applause. Thank you, guys. And don't miss an opportunity. They're going to be on the patio this morning, so connect with them, enjoy them. We're going to be meeting as an outreach board with Gus as we continue to pray through what that can look like as we partner with him in planting more churches in India, just like we do in Sacramento. So continue to pray for that. The second implication for this morning is that the offer of grace in all of our OST journeys. I don't know about how many times a guy like Gus gets up on stage, you're like, man, I want that faith. Anybody want Gus's faith? Anybody? Like, you should raise your hand. It would be way better for you, right? And there's times like, well, that's just so far off, because I look at my life and I go, there's like this much Gus and there's like this much Drew, right? And I feel that way with Peter. If you read the disciples, and sometimes you put people in this category, but here's the reality. Gus and Drew and Peter, all of our OST journeys are rooted in grace. It's rooted in stumbling. Remember Peter last week? It's rooted in denial. Peter was one of these disciples that Jesus is talking to with the crowds around. And think about the life of Peter. I guarantee you there were moments in Peter's life where he would have been allured by wealth, right? But he left his nets and he followed Jesus. In fact, Peter was one of the disciples in Acts 2 where they sold everything and they started to live in common together because they recognized that nothing they had was of any eternal good unless they used it for eternity. I love that. I guarantee you there are moments in Peter's life where health mattered to him probably too much. And he's like, well, wait a second. Like, if I follow Jesus, remember, he denied Jesus 3 times on the night he was betrayed, remember? 3 times. You know why? Because he's like, well, Jesus being crucified, and if I don't deny him, maybe so too will I. So are there moments that Peter struggled with wealth? Are there moments that Peter struggled with health? Yes, but here's the good news. In his ongoing spiritual transformation journey, OST as we call it, Peter actually died for his faith. He trusted God to believe that his better was better. And I don't think for many of us, death might be in our future, but if it was, are we ready? I hope so. That's what it means to be a disciple. And I guarantee you there were moments for Peter's life where he was tempted to believe that family deserved the seat of his throne. He loved his mother-in-law. Remember, he even asked Jesus to heal her back in chapter 5. He cared for his family, but he said, I recognize family's not defined by my blood, but by his blood that was shed that unites us all. And so Peter's in this process. Disciples, we're in this process. I love, but here's what I promise you. I don't know Gus that well, but I promise you, that boy's a sinner. Is that true? Saved by grace, redeemed by the gospel, and now living the gospel. And that's what God wants for all of us, because being a disciple is worth it. It's worth it. More joy in Jesus is not just a hashtag. It is a belief that we have and that we experience as saints. As we look at our lives and our one, man, how many of you guys need to repent this morning? Anybody? Am I the only one? We come to repent, to say, God, I'm sorry for all the things I put on the throne of my life. I want to have a deep relationship with you. R2, anyone, as we think about R2, I did a CrossFit workout yesterday. It was a partner while we were supposed to do it evenly. We were supposed to like share the same amount of reps. My boy carried me. Like, I couldn't do all the work. I'm like, right? I mean, this whole working out monthly is not a good workout plan. But maybe you're like a monthly Christian. Hear me, please. Please, we need each other. We need each other to pick us up when we can't do it. And we need each other to remind ourselves, hey, man, I'm a bonehead too. But God loves boneheads because they don't rely on themselves. They rely on him. And finally, R3, we need this engaging relationship with pre-believers. We need to pray and watch. R3 discipleship is not R1 or R2 or R3. It's R3. It's all of it. And here's what I love about the bacon for Benson. What did Benson do with his plate of bacon when he got back to his seat? Anyone around Benson?
He ate it all.
He didn't eat it all. Susie, what'd you get? You got some bacon? John, you got some bacon? Guys, God has given us grace and love, and he cares for us, and he gives it to us, ultimately, so it will go through us. Father God, thank you for your grace today. May we not forget that you gave that to us so that we might be the givers of that to others. May we not forget the call of discipleship on our lives, and the call is for our good, that the call is for your glory, that the call gives us joy as we radically and maybe even at times recklessly follow you, because you are calling us in faith to say yes to whatever you're inviting us into. So right now, Jesus, on behalf of my brothers and my sisters, I repent for the times this week in our lives when we've settled for lesser joys. I repent for the times that we didn't believe that you were enough. And I pray over them that in this moment we would be reminded for your glory, of your goodness, that we would be reminded of your grace, that we would be reminded of the joy that is offered in you. We'd be reminded that you, Jesus, are more than enough.